I'm waiting for the slides to go on. But in the meanwhile, how many of you are, I'm assuming this is the 10 million to 50 million ARR companies. Even if you're not, that's fine. My content covers that too. Oh, here we go. Other people didn't get clickers. I did. So today I'm going to talk to you about beyond customer acquisition. A little bit about myself. First of all, why should you even listen to me? I was with IBM for about 2.5 years, about 10 years with LinkedIn, and then I've consulted with a lot of VC companies, and I was with Bessemer up until last week. So I've been on both sides of the game. I've seen the common mistakes that startups make, and if you feel like coming forward, you can. That's fine too. I don't bite. How many of you have a comms person at the company? Or do you work with an agency? Okay, fair. I had to ask you this question because the number three I talked about is communications. So if you look at how startups progress, when you're in the 0 to 1 million ARR, you're basically setting up some basic logo, a little bit about your story, and then you're just focusing on customer acquisition. The reason for that is also simple, because all investors are asking you is ROI. They're saying, okay, if you're spending $1, what are you getting out of it? And so all startups end up just focusing on that one thing, which is getting customers, retaining the customers, and that's all it is, like either through events, social presence, or demand gen, right? Here are the three things we're going to talk about today, which is when should you be building a functional team? We're going to talk about brand and a unified brand experience and why that matters. When you are at 1 million ARR, people think of you as a startup. You make mistakes. You don't come across as what you're supposed to be. It's forgiven. When you hit 10 million ARR, it has to stop being founder-led. You have to have functional expertise in place. And the reason for that is you cannot scale beyond 10, beyond 50, if you don't have a functional team that is not the founding team. The founders have to be able to focus on other things that matter. Because at 10 million, people are looking at you and expecting, even your customers are expecting you to be at a certain standard. Which means there has to be someone whose job it is to do that. And so then, when do you look at hiring these people? Different people. I'm assuming these slides are going to be available, and that's the link. Definitely read this. I think this is a really good piece of content. But the reason for this is, yes, you can have a marketing expert by 4 million ARR. The rest of you have homework to do and add more people to your team. And the second thing I'm going to talk about is building a unified brand. Now, how many of you know that whatever your logo is, those are the colors that land up in the presentations? There's no real brand there. No one's thinking about unified experience, how we are coming across. What are people thinking? What are people saying about us? And your brand is really what people are saying about you when you're not in the room. So how are you coming across, especially with social media, especially with online channels? How are you coming across? Is it same? I mean, it won't be the exact same thing across all channels, but at least is it unified? Are we using the right colors? Are we portraying what our essence is? That needs to be thought through. I mean, I want to give you a few examples. They're cliched. But ever walk into an Apple store and say, like, this doesn't feel like Apple? It's the same everywhere. And what does it signify? They talk about creativity. And you'll see it everywhere. Even in an Apple store, you go in, and they'll be conducting some sessions around how to use, I don't know, GarageBand or whatever. Like, I walked in, and that's what I saw, and I was like, ooh, never used it before. But creativity, that's their essence. And whatever they do has that. Nike is all about performance. You all know the taglines. You all know which best shoe to wear. And they will get, that's their entire brand essence. And Coca-Cola, even though it's not the greatest thing for your health, talks about happiness. So all their campaigns, everything they come through, talks about happiness in different ways. So who are you? And have you thought about what your brand stands for? And if you haven't, find out who you are and do it on purpose. I mean, I can go into detail here and I can take hours, but I know you all are hungry, so I'll be nice. Anyone wants to know more about this, I can talk about this, but basically you need to have a theme in place, which is, what is our main theme? Like, is it happiness? Is it productivity? Is it, I don't know, customer success? Like the person who was talking before me. What are the images we will look at? And it shouldn't really be just the logo colors, right? Like, in all my presentation, I haven't just used the purple or SaaS Insider. I could have, but that wouldn't be ideal. What is the voice and tone? How do you want to come across on social channels? I don't know, something's happening with the voice here, and I'm going up and down, but you guys are okay, right? All good. And then what is your brand expression? So again, each one of this can be like a two-hour thing, and you will kill me. So I'm moving on to that for the third thing, which will blow your minds, and that is communications. Yeah. Yeah. In fact, while I was with Bessemer, I actually helped one of the companies do a full rebrand. You will be seeing that coming out soon. And I can't talk about which the company is, but I'll let you know. But like funding announcements, and that's my next point, when you come to comms, all the startups just look at funding announcements as their main announcement or communication, and all you do is reach out to your agencies and says, this is the announcement. No one's thinking through, okay, do we want to build thought leadership? Okay, wait, let me go into comms. But yeah, to answer your question, the answer is yes, because all startups are looking initially at product market fit, and then customer acquisition the minute they have product market fit, and then sales motion. And they don't really focus on marketing, they're just focusing on customer acquisition. Okay. So in comms, why do you need a communications person? I asked you guys, do you have a comms person? And most of you said no. The founding team will probably have a sense of what they want to say, what they want the company to stand for. But a comms person is going to help you define that vision, mission, and values, which is going to help as you scale. When you are beyond 50 million, you do need each and every employee to be as engaged as anyone else, right? Because what's stopping them from moving on? If I want a junior customer service person to still be as engaged, I need them to understand what the values are. I need them to understand how we are actually trying to achieve what is our mission, what is our vision. And a comms person can help you do that, along with the founder, obviously. They're not going to make stuff up. And the only thing you'll see, more likely than not, is the funding announcement that you made, I don't know, 6 months back, or a follow-on. And what most agencies do is they tell you, okay, give us 3-4 things with, okay, there's a funding announcement, there's actually a product. And how can we build that? And so if you actually work even with an agency, you need to have someone tell them, like, we need this going out every potential employees. More fundraising. Because they're saying, seeing what you're doing, it's not, you're not clubbing 5 announcements into one. You're actually making one announcement each. You're saying, okay, this product feature was done. Here are the number of people who enjoy it. And you're doing it in a way that's earned. You're not advertising it. That's how you're building a reputation online. Yes and no. If it is paid, then it has to say advertisement. Otherwise, it's earned. And getting your company featured in an editorial manner is kind of like a sales cycle in itself. You will actually be talking to a few journalists. You'll identify which journalists, cover the kind of stuff you do, then talk to a few journalists, see if there's interest, see why, and eventually close the deal. But yeah, like, it's a long process, but it helps you over time. This part is where I've already covered it, which was basically, do you want to do only one press release with 5 different things, or do you want to have a periodic message going out into the world? At 50 million, people want to know more about you. At 50 million, you have enough customers. At 50 million, journalists want to know what's next coming from you. And I think communication is an engine that you need to push, drive, whatever. And finally, comms can also help with internal communications. Most of you have had a team expand very rapidly, and I don't care what you say, not everybody has the same level of information. It's just not possible the minute you go beyond 100 people. So you do need an internal comms person, and believe it or not, like, amongst all the companies I've worked for, LinkedIn was probably the best company ever. And the reason for that was the entire leadership team used to spend 1 hour every 2 weeks giving updates to the entire company. And anyone could ask any questions. They used to give information about fundraising, information about share prices. They would say, we do trust you and do not let this go out, but it would be like a one-to-one. Everybody knew the same level of information. And you need that to have your employees engaged. And so these are the main things that I wanted to talk about. I'm pretty sure no one's going to ask me, why should we do this or go beyond customer engagement, customer retention and customer acquisition? Well, here's why.
Ms. Anjuman, so basically I want to ask, apart from funding news and feature releases basically, what other examples do you have for a SaaS company for periodic PR basically? It sometimes we don't have anything as such to release a PR.
That's because you're working with an agency, you need a comms person. Every customer you onboard is a customer win announcement. Every single leader that you hire is a leadership team building announcement.
Okay.
What else can you think of? Like literally, there are many, many things that you can actually use to get coverage. You just have to identify the right publication. It could also be just like, you know, an update to like an internal comms thing that went out, right? Like when Amazon was hit badly by the press and they talked about the culture being very aggressive, they had an internal email that they penned, they put it up by Jeff Bezos on his LinkedIn profile, and that they shared with media, and that was covered. I mean, of course, you have to be Amazon for it to be covered. Maybe that won't be covered all the time, but there are like, you need a comms mind to think through, okay, is this media worthy? Is this something I want to do? It could just be thought leadership. Like one of our companies was acquiring another company and the release could have just been like acquisition announcement. But you could actually start about, okay, why? So you talked about the fact that that particular benefit that they would get after the acquisition did not exist in the market. Okay, it's already live, so I'll tell you. So MediAssist was acquiring Mayfair and they didn't really have, like the comms agency just said, okay, we'll do the funding announcement. But I said, okay, where's the thought leadership piece? Can we talk about borderless benefits? Because if that's the value proposition you're going after, let's have a thought leadership piece on it. Then you do the acquisition announcement, which includes, by the way, all of the unified stuff that we talked about, right? Like, I mean, MediAssist also has MediBuddy, which has Amitabh Bachchan. Can we include that in the influencer for social? So like you have the on day off, and after, again, you can talk about borderless benefits in a different light. So you need like a full plan. You need someone who can advise you on how to build the story and which is a story.
And just to ask, any good example of companies who are doing very good PRs?
That sounds more like marketing, my friend. We were talking about comms, but yes. Yeah, I mean, I think it depends on the publication too, right? Like if you have a marketing product, then trade publications like Ad Age and Ad Factors, all of these come into play. Not always Economic Times, because you're not going to get Economic Times all the time. But you could get like Business Standard in the same month. You could get Mint the next month. And that's how you kind of play the game. But the news is out there and you're building your reputation. Any other questions?
What's the challenge in HR owning internal comms?
There isn't a challenge. I think it depends. Like if you're a company like LinkedIn, and if you have HR owning comms, that doesn't work because it's a big company. And so you'd rather have internal comms, people manage internal comms, but then their stakeholders are HR. As an external comms person, their stakeholders will be like the spokespeople, like external spokespeople, like the CEO or the sales officer or something like that. It all depends on how the company is structured. I don't see either as a challenge. Unless it's big enough and then you can learn from the functional experts, again, like it depends from company to company. I feel like you can't be doing one thing in marketing and comms has no clue and they're saying something else altogether. So there has to be some way for them to talk to each other. And if that's not something that happens, then that's a problem. But if it happens, it's all good. Like, I don't know if you know, but Shannon Stuber was the corporate communications head at LinkedIn, and then she ended up to becoming the CMO for LinkedIn. Because like just the reach of comms across all marketing functions was, it needed to be integrated. Now you can't be telling a member, okay, you need to get the premium account and here's why in a marketing blast, and at the same time you're doing a comms program around, you actually don't need it. Because the freemium model is what we work on. Like, that doesn't work, right? Any other questions? I know I'm keeping you from lunch. Go ahead. Sorry, you're next.
So I've worked with the startup, and we used to spend like 5 to 6%, you know, through, like, could you talk about some metrics that kind of help bring in, you know, how do you see the value that PR is generating? Some metrics that you track.
I don't think that, okay, so there are many metrics that different people use. There's like ad value, which is like the very old, antiquated way of looking at it. I used to actually look at message pull through and identifying which are the different publications we want to be featured in. And if we got that, we've nailed the, like if, let's say tech branding is a focus for you, then getting in Economic Times is not your best bet. You want to get into a tech-featured magazine like a CIO or something else that an engineer is going to read, right? If your focus is actually just how well the company is doing, how many numbers you're making is not going to be of interest to an engineer. So you need to know your focus, whether it's trade PR, tech branding, corporate PR. There are some B2B companies that we work with, or I used to work with up until last week, that talked about, because they were doing banking software, they actually did like a data pull, obfuscated obviously, and said, here's actually how we see demand growing pre-COVID levels. It's an interesting data-based angle for communications story, but that got them in Economic Times. So, you know, there's a lot that you have that you don't know is actually valuable in terms of PR. You do need someone who can advise and say like, okay, this is your data set. If you can just glean 5 different things from it, you can turn it into a campaign. Do you know Netflix did a campaign on cheating on your partners? Which basically was you started one particular series together and one of you watched it ahead of time. Like you didn't do it together. And they called it like the cheating quotient. And then they did this whole campaign around the world around, you know, 80% of people cheat on their partners. It's very clickbaity, but kind of sold the message, right? Like, this is binge-worthy stuff. And then they talked about which content people cheated on. So there are interesting ways to get your product out there. You just need someone who thinks like that. Or you need to think like that. When I was at LinkedIn, and I could not support it. So I actually did like a survey because that's the only way I could get the journalist interested and came up with insights that would be interesting to the journalists. And so we used to call it like PR is like the air cover and then your troops go in through marketing. Like he said, like if you don't have PR running made which is not supporting the business goals is useless. Yeah. And I mean, I can give you templates later offline, but like there's across business lines, here are the 5 things we will talk about in these 4 quarters. And this, I would not come up out of the goodness of my brains. It would come from the business leaders, right? Like, what do we want to talk about? What is the focus for your business for this year, this quarter? Thank you very much. I'm still here, so we can talk anytime. Thank you.